Snapdragon 8 Gen 1. It's the new name of Qualcomm's latest mobile platform, the successor of Snapdragon 888, and we will definitely see it very often powering next year's Android flagship smartphones. Personally, I think it's pretty weird to change your product naming scheme every generation or so, but other than the name, we care about its performance and power efficiency. You might know that Snapdragon 888 this year suffered some serious thermal issue, which leads to those flagship phones not performing very well. The actual gaming performance of Snapdragon 888 is not anywhere better than 865 platform, I think. So will Qualcomm fix all these problems this year, or it will be just another burner heating up your smartphone? That's what I'm going to tell you in this video. Before we run into some tests, let's talk about the architecture. The new Snapdragon 8 Gen 1 is the first mobile SoC platform that supports ARM v9 instruction set. If you remember in 2013 when the industry moves from ARM v7 towards ARM v8, that brought mobile processing to 64 bits, which was a big deal. Apple made this crazy A7 chip based on ARM v8, which was way ahead of Snapdragon at the time. However, in terms of raw performance, ARM v9, on the other hand, isn't that exciting. Most of the improvements of v9 are focused on the security and scalability side. One of the important features of ARM v9 is the scalable vector extension 2, known as SVE2. Essentially speaking, ARM chips running on your phone, on the desktop PCs, and in data center, although they're all ARM-based processors, have very different size of their vector registers. Which means software designed for data center will not be able to run on your smartphone easily, or vice versa. But with SVE2, it's a different story. Without the limitation of vector lens, developers only need to compile once to make their software working on all ARM platforms. I mean, running data center stuff on your smartphone? Wow, that's pretty cool actually. But anyway, we can see the ambition of ARM is to build an ecosystem to compete with x86 on desktop and data center market. So it's all about the future. And for the current generation of smartphone, it doesn't really matter. What does improve the performance though is the new CPU core design. They've been upgraded to Cortex X2, Cortex A710, and Cortex A510, finally ditching the old A55. The new bigger X2 core is not a whole lot different from the old X1. They reduced the pipeline length, got a bigger out-of-order window, improved the branch prediction, and stopped supporting 32-bit apps. But the Cortex X2 is not a completely new design though. It is still originated from A76 of 2018, designed by ARM's Austin, Texas team, so it won't be a big leap forward anyway. The same story happens in the middle core, A710. It is really likely that next year we will receive a huge improvement from the brand new core architecture designed by ARM's French team. But before that, we won't really have any choice. The new efficient core, A510, however, is a new IP designed in ARM's headquarters in Cambridge. On paper, the IPC has improved by 35% to 50%, so sounds pretty impressive. But from our point of view, most of the improvements might be achieved by increasing the scale. For example, they increased the decoder, increased the ALUs, all of which will contribute to a higher power consumption. And that means the performance per watt won't be so pretty. Another interesting design is that a 510 core does not work by itself. You need to put two cores side by side and let them share its L2 cache and floating point units. This actually reminds me of the AMD Bulldozer, and that is not a glorious memory. But for efficient cores, I think it might not be a really bad idea. It's a small core anyway, powering the background activities for the most time, which doesn't require the floating points a lot. Aside from the new architecture, Snapdragon 8 Gen 1 also increased the level 3 cache from 4 MB to 6 MB. This is still not a huge number because MediaTek managed to put 8 MB of level 3 cache into their chip. So maybe that is reserved for Snapdragon 8 Gen 2, I guess? Cache will usually have some significant impact on CPU performance, so we will see it in a minute. What also matters to the gaming experience is the GPU inside. They put a newly designed Adreno 730 GPU in there. The 600 series GPU on the previous gen of Snapdragon SoC has put Android phone way behind the iPhone in terms of graphic performance. But Snapdragon Agent 1 might be a turnover. Oh, almost forgot to mention the Agent 1 is still fabricated by Samsung with an improved 4nm node. And as we know from the Snapdragon 888 or AAA chip, their performance, I mean Samsung's performance per watt on 5nm were not so ideal comparing with, let's say, TSMC. Will that improve this time? Well, it's time to test it out. First of all, let's talk about the CPU performance. Here's the result of Geekbench 5. For the multi-core score, Snapdragon Agent 1 got a 3810, which is only 60 higher than the Snapdragon 888. A 1.5% improvement. Whoa, seriously, Qualcomm? On V9, new core design, 4nm fabrication, and you only got 1.5% better than the old generation? Wow. The single core performance is also not a lot better. It's just like 5.7% better than the 888. And that is still worse than Apple's A13 chip, which was released 3 years ago. Considering that Cortex X2 cores is running at 3 GHz, which is already higher than the 888, we can basically say that the IPC hasn't improved too much, right? Well, it's bad news for Qualcomm. Alright, since the performance hasn't improved that much, you might think maybe the power consumption is lower, right? No, this is even worse. During Geekbench 5, on average, we recorded 4.2 watts of power consumption on single core and 11.1 watts on multi-core. If we look at the peak value, we got as high as 14 watts. It's on a phone, a freaking smartphone. It doesn't even have a fan on it. That's just terrifying. Well, I suppose these new CPU architectures really didn't improve that much. And the Samsung 4nm node is still not doing its job really well. Okay, the CPU is a bit disappointing, but how about its GPU? We are on GFXBench 5.0 benchmark, and wow, that GPU is not bad. The GPU of Snapdragon Agent 1 is already better than Apple A14 when running on OpenGL, and if we run the Vulkan test, it could even be comparable with A15. This is almost 16% better than the Snapdragon 888. Nice job, Qualcomm. Nice job. But how about the power numbers? Well, we got 11.2 watts on average. I mean, this GPU has the same power consumption as Apple M1.
The competition is still playing catch up to our chip.
Yeah, I guess they are right. Keep going, Qualcomm, you almost got them. Based on these numbers we got, there's no way you can run this thing without throttling on any phones. So how about a stress test? We are using the game Nimble Legends Bright Ridge as a tool to stress test our phones. This is a game that can suck up every single drop of juice out of your smartphone GPU while providing a comparable graphic setting among different platforms, I mean Android and iOS. We run the test for 10 minutes to see how the frame rate drops. And Snapdragon Agent 1 is really not bad this time. The peak performance is even on par with A15, and although it does throttle pretty heavily, the curve is still fine since Apple's chip also drops a lot. And if we put an even bigger load on it, like a 3D Mark Wildlife Extreme Stress Test, we got a 66.8% of stability. And that means the GPU performance drops to 66.8% after 20 cycles. That's definitely not ideal compared to others. But let's look at the bright side. Even after throttling, the performance is still better than the peak of Snapdragon 888. But hey, unlike on PCs, most of the mobile games does not fully utilize your phone's GPU, so pushing your phone to its absolute limit isn't that indicative. I think we need a mid-load GPU test to infer your everyday gaming scenario. So we are still using Bright Ridge, lower down the resolution to 1080p and lock the frame rate to 30, then record the power consumption. And as we can see, Snapdragon Agent 1's GPU still draws a lot of power under mid-level load. Performance per watt is a bit better than the 888, but it still kind of sucks since it's even worse than 865, a 2019 chip. So how about if we run some actual big titles like Genshin Impact? Since the graphic preset on iPhone is higher than the Android version, we will use a comparable setting among all devices, using the same character and running through the same path at Liyue Harbor. Games like Genshin Impact will adjust the rendering scale based on the device you're using, and it will not tell you the exact rendering resolution in the setting menu. So to generalize the test, we try to do the pixel count. Maybe miHoYo hasn't optimized their games for the new piece of silicon. The rendering resolution of our Gen1 platform won't exceed 640p, while other Android flagships can go as high as 720p. So it's a little bit lower. We prepared three tests for Genshin Impact: the normal pressure test, the high pressure test, and the nightmare test. And here's the condition of each test below. Going on to the high pressure test first, over the first 3 minutes, Gen1 is not bad at all, an almost stable 60 frames per second. Also, the CPU clock speed is very aggressive and our smartphone draws about 7.6 watts of power. Apparently this won't last long, so we are seeing some throttling after 3 minutes. Over the full 13 minutes test, we got an average of 55 fps, and the power consumption is 6.3 watts. So the performance does get better than, let's say, 888, but the power consumption is about the same. The improvement actually comes from the CPU, because our GPU only utilized that 56%. So while Geekbench score didn't improve that much, game does benefit from the new CPUs. In terms of powers, 6.3 watts is not a small number at all on the smartphone, and highest temperature can go as high as 48 degrees. Next, we try to lower down the settings and take the normal pressure test. And here we can get a stable 60 FPS for about 6 minutes, a bit longer, before throttling happens. The average frame rate over 30 minutes is 57 FPS, a lot better than the 888 platform, but the power consumption is about the same. Just in case you really want to torture your phone to death, we designed this Genshin Impact Nightmare test using 5G connection to play the game in a super hot environment. Well, in this case, you got an average of 48 frames per second. And luckily, the game stays stable, didn't crash, which is not bad. And the Snapdragon Gen1 actually performs better than all the other platforms in this crazy test. But the temperature of our smartphone is climbing up to 53 degrees Celsius. It can literally burn your skin if you hold it long enough. Anyway, the Snapdragon Gen1 is, it's hard to say. It's not a completely waste of sand. It got a decent GPU that almost as good as Apple's A15, and the gaming performance is kinda okay, I guess. However, I couldn't say Snapdragon Gen1 is a great chip at all, because the CPU part hasn't really changed that much despite a brand new ARMv9 architecture, and the power efficiency is actually sucks. I'm really expecting the flagship phones next year will get heavier and thicker just to fit a larger battery and thermal solution inside. So yeah, this is our conclusion on the Snapdragon 8 Gen 1. So thanks for watching this video. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel and leave a like button if you like it. See you next time.